I will ask Abir Das Gupta to please give us his views on what is happening exactly at Godda. Abir, we can't see you yet. Abir is an investigative journalist who's been working with Paranjoy, and they've been focusing on the Adani Godda project. Abir has gone many times to the field and written reports from there. There you are, Abir. We can see you. Can't hear you yet.
Thank you. Thank you, Vidya, for affording me this opportunity. And thanks to everyone who's joined us. Now, Sridhar has covered in his detailed presentation the Godda power plant project in great detail. So I just want to sort of zoom out and look at the bigger picture in relation to the Adani Group. Now, I have been working on researching the Adani Group in a lot of close detail for over 3 years now in collaboration with Paranjoy. And I want to make a couple of remarks to understand how this company functions and what activists in Bangladesh can possibly look out for. Now, the first thing to pay attention to is how the Adani Group's business model works, how they expand. And the main attribute of this is vertical integration. They usually start from one core project, a land-intensive project, that then expands into ancillary segments. This is the case that we've seen in Adani's flagship business in Mundra in Gujarat, where they started from a port and expanded that port complex into a special economic zone. Through that, they got into power generation and into logistics. And from power, they then expanded into coal mining and now into transmission. Now, if the Godda project is seen through to fruition, then that to me suggests that Adani may seek to enter through the transmission segment into other areas in Bangladesh as well. Now, in India recently, Adani acquired the Mumbai City Power Distribution contract, for example, expanding its transmission business. So this is all one possibility that can be considered. Now, the second point I want to make is the manner in which the Adani Group approaches what it calls government relations or government liaison. This is something that was told to us, to Paranjoy and myself, by a person who worked directly with Gautam Adani, that the company has a specific approach to what it calls environment management. And the two prongs of this approach are to ingratiate itself among the relevant regulators and ministries in the different level of government, and to target dissenting voices and those who raise questions. In India, this is a process that is obviously quite advanced. On the one hand, several of us journalists who cover the Adani Group and activists associated with people's movements relating to Adani projects have faced legal and other forms of harassment. Whereas on the other hand, there are numerous Indian bureaucrats and officials who have gone on to enjoy lucrative post-retirement positions courtesy of the Adani Group. Now, this is a trend that is developing in Australia as well. And this is something that, once again, I would like to flag as consideration for activists in Bangladesh. Now, the third, if one can call it that, common element that connects Adani's projects across multiple locations in India, in Australia, also in Indonesia, where it is involved in coal mining and in palm oil, is that in multiple instances, the indigenous communities are affected by the Adani Group's projects. This, of course, ties into larger global trends. But in Adani's case, if we look at how resistance campaigns have developed across these locations, indigenous solidarity and community action has played a central role in organizing movements that focus on questions relating to energy and the environment. Now, this is the case with the Godda power plant. The people's movement in Godda that has arisen has been powered by an Adivasi or indigenous people's organization. This is, of course, the case in Australia as well with regard to the Carmichael coal mine project. Now, in the past 2 years, I think we're beginning to see possibilities, growing possibilities for collaboration between the different people's movements in India and Australia, with multiple different stakeholders coming together around opposition to this project. And I think it can only bode well for such efforts for voices from Bangladesh to be brought forward into the mix. In February of this year, I visited Godda to speak to the communities that are affected by Adani's power plant. And these are detailed in reports that were published by Adani Watch in Australia and NewsClick in India. Now, as Sridhar detailed, the plan here is for coal mined by Adani in Queensland in Australia to be shipped over 10,000 kilometers to Godda in Jharkhand in India, and for the power there to be generated there to be exported to Bangladesh. The campaign in Godda has focused on the question of land acquisition, on the question of the expropriation of land held by members of the community under conditions that they've challenged at a number of different forums. One thing that the people that I met emphasized was that when they asked government officials that why is this project being rushed through in this manner, they were told that it serves a public purpose and that thereby the land acquisition process was justified. And when they asked what is the public purpose that the project is serving, since it isn't going to be supplying power to the state of Jharkhand or anywhere in India, they were told that it's a part of the subject of a deal between the governments of India and Bangladesh. Now, as we know, this is a project that it appears is the subject of close personal interest at the highest levels of the Indian government. Prime Minister Narendra Modi, in a visit to Australia, flagged this project as a crucial component of India's bilateral relations with Australia. And the deal in whereby Bangladesh was chosen as the buyer of Godda's power was also one that was done by Prime Minister Modi with the Prime Minister of Bangladesh. Now, what I'm suggesting is that if a clear voice arises from civil society in Bangladesh, raising the question of whether the country really needs this power supply from Adani's plant in Godda, this can bring about a change in the calculus of the various stakeholders. And as it has come together, as of now, the entity that benefits the most from the entire deal is the Adani group, not the community in Australia or in India or in Bangladesh. Huge subsidies are being provided by the governments, by all three governments involved. And financing for the project is also one that the governments appear to be attempting to influence the process. In one case, of course, famously, the chairperson of the State Bank of India promised a $1 billion credit line to Adani for this project that was announced while the Prime Minister and Gautam Adani and this chairperson, Arundhati Bhattacharya, were in Australia. And there are various other measures by which we can come to the same conclusion. So in that context, I see such a meeting as a very promising beginning for dealing with a company like Adani that operates across borders in the entire region. Public action and activism must also be based on an internationalist spirit. And with that, I thank Mehdi and Vidya and everyone else involved in bringing together this Indo-Bangla Energy Dialogue. Thank you very much.